first Sunday of the year. Good to see such a good crowd out. Good to see, and of course, I was telling Carolyn, we've got a good crowd, and we've got several of our regulars out. Dan and Karen, I think Karen's feeling bad. I'm not sure about Jewel and Carol, and Martha and Henry are not here, so they're six right off the top of my head that we're missing. So let's certainly keep those folks in our prayers. If you're visiting with us, we're glad to have you here. If you're following us on YouTube, certainly want to invite you to be back with us or be with us anytime that you can. Just looking out, it's just good to have our regular church family. A lot of little ones in here. That's always encouraging too. And so good to have you here. And good to be here. Always a privilege for me to share God's word with you, especially here on this first Sunday. Well, maybe some of you have made resolutions this year. I'm sure most people usually do. Setting goals is not a bad thing. It's actually good for us to set goals and try to reach those goals. Maybe being at church every Sunday was one of your resolutions. That's a great resolution. I encourage you to do that. Let me put out another one for you. How about Sunday school? We want to continue to make that Sunday school department come on up, which we had. You can see we're up six over last year's Sunday, first Sunday. So that's a great trend, and let's just try to keep that up as well. But whatever you resolve to do this year, try to do your best. If you have a little failure or a setback, don't let that mean to yourself or discourage you that you can't fulfill that goal. Because oftentimes when we set goals to do something, we'll have a little setback. That doesn't mean we're a failure. We're only a failure when we stop trying to meet that goal. So let me encourage you to continue to do that. Be committed. That's the key to reaching a goal. And I believe that this congregation is a good example of being committed, or their commitment to serving the Lord. Do you realize that this year, 2020, is our 190th anniversary? That's a long time. That's a pretty good start about being committed to something, isn't it? This congregation has been meeting together for 190 years in this community. One of the oldest congregations, certainly in Laurel County, but what you may not realize, it's one of the older congregations in the state of Kentucky. So that's something to be proud of and something to think about. And the commitment. And just to run down how we do that, and I want us to continue to think about this year, the 190th year, the commitment we have. I want us to think about this morning who we are as Locust Grove Christian Church. I'm not going to sit and talk about who we're not, because there's a lot of congregations we could compare ourselves to in the county, in the community of Keeby, that we're not. But I want to just kind of go over a few things and remind us about who that we are as a congregation. We are a congregation that has Sunday school that serves groups from early elementary all the way up to adults. And as I said earlier, I hope that we see our attendance grow this year. We're a congregation that has children's church each Sunday. And we have a group of volunteers that we usually offer services for two different age groups. We also have a youth group, Sunday nights for all ages. And hopefully we can get that to the point where we split that youth group and have two different age groups, or three. If the age ranges of the children that are here this morning are any indication, that won't be too far away, really, as well for us to have. We conduct VBS each and every year. Averaged around 50 kids over that 3 or 5 day vacation Bible school. Lessons are prepared and taught. Good snacks are fed each night. Crafts and games are played. Bus ministry. We have that bus ministry that runs on Sunday mornings, though we don't use the bus now because we just have one pastor that we pick up. But should we have requests for those, that service, it could easily expand out to more. What about our sound room? We don't think about that often, do we? sound room is run. We have nice equipment for that. We're able to produce video. The sound room folks also put us on the internet with YouTube, so people, not only our own church members, can see services if you miss on Sunday morning, but we have people all around the United States that have access, well, around the world, that have access to that. What about something that we just finished up with, Operation Christmas Child? We sent over 300 boxes this past year, and it's grown every year since we began to do it because of your support. Our music department, we don't often think about that. We have a music department, but we do. We have song leaders and pianists that provide music for us each and every Sunday. And again, I'm going to put out, you notice that Sue Ann, she is feeling better, but she's just not got her strength back up yet, so she wasn't able to be here. So you can see that we have a need for a backup pianist. So there's an opportunity for someone. What about the Christmas for the kids at Kiwi? We often forget about that until it's time for it to happen, but typically we provide clothing and toys for 12 children down there. Back to school blessings. We provide school supplies and backpacks for kids at the poor area, our closest elementary schools of Wine Pine, Cold Hill, Kiwi, and Hunter Hills. Do you begin to see who we are as a congregation? We have Trunk or Treat, and that's the one that's been the biggest surprise to me, is how that we have seen that grow and grow and grow, and the effect that that ministry has. Last year, last October, we had over 100 kids, and then their parents or whoever was accompanying those folks. And it was a bad night. It was an awful night, if you remember. Rainy and cold. But it still, we got to reach a lot of people in our community. Christmas at the camp. I don't know how many they finally, did they ever get a total of how many they have for both? 900 or so people that were able to come through those cabins and see. Kitchen staff. We often don't, and maybe we take for granted our kitchen staff, but those folks work tirelessly over there to provide our meals that we have for fellowships, meals, holiday meals, our fellowship breakfast, special service meals, and then any time that we serve a funeral meal, they're in there. And so certainly we appreciate that. And then last but certainly not least, our board of deacons and elders. They do a great job handling our church business. We have a financially stable congregation, and those men do a really good job about how we spend our money. And we also use that to serve our community. And then on top of that, we have that visitation program where we still go out and visit those shut-in at the nursing homes, maybe in their own homes. And that tells us, to me, that tells us who we are. You know, for the longest time, whenever I began to serve here, I thought about how we needed, what we needed, those types of things come into my mind. And as I have grown with this congregation, I realize that this is who we are, and this is what we do, and I'm good with that, because we do a great job. We serve our community very well, and I outlined that just by what we do. And I hope that even though you know all that list of things that I read over, you know that. But have you ever thought about that? That's who we are. That's how we serve our community. We don't need necessarily, not saying that we wouldn't ever add another program, but we don't need another program. We have several programs that we outreach our community to. We have people that fill those roles. There's always room for more people to work in these areas of ministry. And I encourage you to do that. You can find something to do here and get plugged into that, because some of these ministries, some of these activities are headed up by one person. Some of them are two or three, and some of them not by anybody in particular. But those are opportunities for us as a congregation to continue on. And that's why I think this congregation has been successful for 190 years. Though we may not look like XYZ church over here or ABC church over there, we look exactly like Locust Grove Christian Church. And we do exactly what we need to do and have been doing for our community for 190 years. So just wanted us to think about that. It sounds like a group of committed people to me that would go through these many ministries and do what we do. Now, how do we continue? How do we continue in this for not just talking about this year, but the next 10 years, next 20 years, 30, 40, 50 years? And when we start thinking about those types of time frames, then we automatically, the first thing we have to think about is if you take 30 years removed from today, a very good portion of us will not be here. So that means that we have to be committed and we have to teach commitment to the younger generation so that they can pick up and carry on and take ministries, maybe the same list, but 30 years it may be something a little different. May look a little different because of what the needs are in the community. But what makes those programs successful is the commitment of the people that are doing it. And that's what we have to be reminded of. And that's what I want us to think about as we think about who we are, is that commitment. This morning I want to look at two or three points, and we're going to look at Peter. So if you want to go ahead and turn over in your Bibles to Luke, that's where our first point is going to come from this morning. But we're going to look at him, and we're going to look at how he stayed committed. Now, I remind you, when we talk about Peter, a very important man to the beginning of the church, one of the apostles, and how he served. But also, we have to remember that Peter, and I'm not saying this to knock him down, I'm saying this to encourage us, Peter failed two or three times. He failed. And that did not stop Peter from being the person that Jesus entrusted to begin and move forward with the church. That's what we have to remember. So let's learn from Peter how he conducted himself and some examples, and maybe we can see how we can be inspired through his example to be committed to staying who we are. In Luke chapter 5, verse 1, and this is a very familiar passage of Scripture, it reads, "And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Now when he had left speaking, he said unto Simon, Launch out into the deep, and let down your nets for a draught. And Simon answered unto him, Master, we have toiled all the night, and have taken nothing. Nevertheless, at thy word I will let down the net. And when they had this done, they enclosed a great multitude of fishes, and their net brake. And they beckoned unto their partners, which were in the other ship, that they should come and help them. And they came and filled both ships so that they began to sink." Verse 7, that's what I thought. What is it about this story that we most commonly think about? Well, one thing is that we never should doubt the blessings from the Lord. But that's not where I want us to go this morning. I want us to think about obedience. That we have to obey what God commands us to do, or we have to obey when God and the Holy Spirit lead us to do something. Now, Simon, Peter, and his partners were professional fishermen. That's how they made their living. They had fished, had given up, they were back taking care of their equipment, and Jesus pressed upon them, prayed, insisted more or less that they go back out and drop out their nets again. Didn't make sense to them. They knew that they had never been successful before at that night's fishing. But for whatever reason, they turned themselves over to the leading of Jesus. And they obeyed Jesus, even though it didn't make a lot of sense to do that. And they went out and they caught so many fish. The Scriptures tells us they filled up two boats to where they was about to sink, to the maximum capacity of what those boats would hold. Now, what's the lesson in it for us? what's the lesson in it for us as people that I want to encourage this morning to stay committed or to be committed or to teach commitment? There's times that God leads us to do things in our lives that doesn't make a lot of sense to us, but it makes perfect sense to the Lord. And that's what we have to realize and be allowed ourselves to be led by the Spirit so that we can see the blessings. And I'm not talking about necessarily monetary blessings or some type of blessing upon us, but what about the blessing that we see here that over and above what you could ever imagine to the point that the boats were ready to sink? Okay? Now, we would think maybe a good blessing would be just to go out and catch, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 baskets of fish. And they probably would have been satisfied with that, especially since they hadn't had no luck earlier that evening. But when we put our trust and our faith in God to do the leading and we just do the following, He's going to fill that boat to the rim, to its maximum capacity, more than we would ever expect. I seen one analogy one time that's what the saucer underneath the cup is for. And so that when your blessings overflowed out of the cup, it would fill the saucer. And that's what God does in our lives when we allow Him to do so. When we follow His leading, when we're committed to doing what God commands or leads us to do, even though it may not make sense to me, we always have to remember it makes perfect sense to God. And that's what we see here with this example of Peter. It didn't make no sense to go out, but his boat overflowed to the point that it began to sink because he obeyed what God had led him to. Trust and obey. We sing that hymn here. For there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. And that's what we have to do. If we call ourselves Christians, if we call ourselves followers of Christ, we have to trust and obey the leading of the Holy Spirit and what the Bible tells us. Now, if you turn over into John, the Gospel of John, chapter 21, in verses 15 through 17, we see Peter at the end of his 3 years with Jesus. That was kind of the beginning. That's when Jesus and Peter met, was there. When he was teaching in Gennesaret and borrowed his boat for a few minutes. Because if you recall, what did he say to him after that? Come and I will make you fishers of men. So that's when he was leaving his life that he knew and began to follow Jesus. Well, we know that through the course of that 3 years that Peter denied Jesus, who he was, he drew out a sword and struck off Malchus's ear. And was rebuked. You know, Jesus told him, you'll deny me 3 times. Jesus also said that him that lived by the sword shall die by the sword. That's when he wiped off Malchus's ear, the rebuke there. So even after using violence whenever Jesus taught peace and love, even after denying Jesus, even when he said, I would never do anything like that, then we come to chapter 21 of John, verses 15 and 17. They had been out fishing again, looked out, and they seen Jesus. And verse 15 says, so when they had dined, Jesus saith unto Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me more than these? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he saith unto him, feed my lambs. And he saith to him again that second time, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, feed my sheep. And then in verse 17, he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonah, lovest thou me? And Peter was grieved because he had said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus said unto him, feed my sheep. So not only do we have to be willing to obey what God commands and leads us to, we have to be willing to step out in faith. We think about what he did. How he the scriptures, the disciples were out on a boat and they were by themselves. Jesus had told them that he would meet them on the other side of the sea there. And a storm came up and the ship was being tossed about, and they were afraid that it was going to sink, if we recall. And they looked up, and who did they see walking across the water? Jesus. And if we recall, who did he beckon or say, who came and said, "Lord, is that you?" And he said, "He is I. Come to me." Me paraphrasing, of course. And what happened with Peter? He walked on the water, didn't he? He walked on the water. I know that has nothing to do with the scripture, but believe it or not, Rob made a mistake when he put the scripture together on the sermon last night. So what I want us to think about is how that Peter stepped out of the boat in faith and walked on water and was a success at doing something that he and you and I and anyone else would think is completely impossible, as long as he what? Kept his eyes on Jesus. If we remember, that's what happened whenever he began to look around him and see what he was doing and thinking about, "Oh my gosh, I'm in the ocean, in the sea here. There's a storm here. I'm going to drown." He took his eye off Jesus. He began to trust in his own knowledge instead of what Jesus was able to do. He began to sink. And then even yet then, Jesus saved him. Stepping out in faith. Now, I want us to think about that in the same manner. I know that there are some people in this room that over the course of the past 12 months of the last year, with the calls that I have made for service areas, the calls that I have made for people to do things, you have felt that call, but then you have pushed it back because you said, "There's no way I can do that. There's no way I have the time. There's no way that I have the ability to do what Rob's asking to be done. Someone else will surely step in that role and fulfill it." I'm telling you this morning, that call is still there. You have the opportunity. The needs are still present in all of the areas that we have, and then even more so now in a couple of areas. I'm asking you to not push back, not to look down and see that you're walking ankle deep in water, but to look up and keep your eyes focused on Jesus and rely on him to make a way for you to do that he's calling you to do. Make a way that you can do what you feel like is impossible to do and serve him. So you have to obey, and then you have to step out in faith. You have to be willing to step out of the boat and put your trust and faith in Jesus and go where he says that you need to go, do what he says you need to do, and trust him to supply the way that you do that. And that's what I want to encourage you to do. And that's what has happened with this congregation for 190 years. That's the whole point I'm trying to make. We would not be here in this 190th year if people for many years before us did not obey what God commanded them to do. There wouldn't be a church here, number one. We wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the fact that people was willing to step out of the boat in faith and follow what the Lord had led them to do. We'd still be under a rock down at the lake. So people, this congregation has been doing that for 190 years, and we have to continue and stay that committed. We have to be willing to step out in faith. And then lastly, John 21, verses 18 and 19. Of course, I want us to catch up here just a second. Verse 7. Remember, the first thing we seen was Peter in a boat from fishing that night before, went back out in a boat and fished. The next story I described and didn't have the scriptures ready for you this morning was when Peter walked on water, as long as he kept his eyes on Jesus. If you look back at verse 7 of chapter 21, disciple whom Jesus loved saith unto Peter, it's the Lord. Now when Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he girded his fisher's coat up to him and did cast himself into the sea. So he went from stepping out in faith that he jumped out of the boat to go see Jesus. He jumped into the ocean to go see Jesus, to be with the Lord. And when they get reunited, all the guys come in, they're sitting around the campfires we just read a few minutes ago, they were eating. Jesus looked at Peter and he said to him three times, and that's no small coincidence, because how many times did Peter deny Jesus? So that's why he did that, just to make sure that he was committed to what he was doing. And then he wanted Peter to know that everything wasn't going to be rosy. Everything wasn't going to be rainbows and cupcakes for him. And that's what we need to understand too, because in verses 18 and 19, Jesus says here, verily, verily, I say unto thee, and he's talking to Peter here now, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest wherever thou would. But when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. This spake he, signifying by the death he should glorify God. When he had spoken this, he saith unto him, follow me. So Jesus tells Peter that someday he would be under the control of someone else. Someone was going to lead him where he really didn't want to go. He was foretelling of the type of death that he was there. Now, Scripture doesn't record, but Christian history records that he was crucified upside down. Was the type of death that he died to glorify God. But he's telling him all of that in the future is going to happen. And he just finished up saying, feed my sheep, right? Feed my sheep, feed my lambs. In other words, take care. You have this great responsibility. Everything's not going to be peachy. Everything's not going to be rosy. You're not going to have the easy path. But I want you to follow me even though things are going to be hard. And that's what we have to be committed to do. And when we think about 190 years of this congregation, it's not been a smooth, easy path for this congregation, yet they persisted. I know at least once, and maybe twice, maybe someone could tell me so it would be accurate, this congregation lost its church building to fire. That would maybe stop a lot of congregations. Well, we'll just go somewhere else. We'll just divide up and go to the other churches in the area where we really don't have the money. This is maybe a sign to us we shouldn't be here. No, that's not the case. That might be what Satan would have you to think. Satan would have you to think because you're having a difficult time in what you're doing that it's not worth it. It's not worth the personal sacrifice. It's not worth the trouble. It's not worth the ridicule or whatever you want to plug in there to stay committed and serve God. But we know that's not the case, because Jesus tells Peter to follow me. But what did Jesus tell all the disciples? You trust in God, trust in me also, didn't he? In my Father's house are what? Many mansions, and I will go there to build one for you. And if I go, I'm coming back. And of course, this is me paraphrasing. If I go and build a mansion or prepare a place for you, then I will return that you may be with me. And that's what we have to remember as congregation and as individuals. That we have to obey where God in the Holy Spirit commands and leads us to go. And we have to be willing to step out of the boat in faith, trusting in Jesus even when it doesn't make a lot of sense to us. We have to be willing to stay the course when things get difficult. We have to be committed because that's who we are. That's who this congregation has been for 190 years. And that's how this congregation will continue serving faithfully until the day Jesus Christ returns. And that's our goal as Christians, is to serve until Christ returns, whether that be through our death or through hearing a trumpet sound and the Lord sending him back. So I'm proud to be part of this congregation. it does for the community of Keeby and its members and the folks that seek out help from us. I hope you are too. I hope that you're proud of what we do. I hope that you're proud of how we serve. And I hope that being so proud, you're willing to tell people what we do here at this congregation. Because it's something to be proud of. It's something to be part of. I would think that there would be hard-pressed to find another congregation that does more than we do. They probably do as much, but find a congregation that does more than we do. And they're a great congregation. I'm not knocking them. I'm just saying that's how good we are. We do a lot. So being committed means that we obey, we step out, we stay faithful. If we're going to make a difference in the lives of the people that we come in contact with, if we're going to make a difference for the kingdom of God, we have to be willing to do these things. Now, I ask you this. To be part of this congregation, you first have to be part and joined to Jesus Christ. You have to have accepted Him as your Savior. Hearing the word, believing, confessing Jesus as Savior and Lord, repenting of your sins, being buried with Him in baptism, raised the new creation, you've received the gift of the Holy Spirit, which will lead us, and you've also received the remission of sins or forgiveness of sins, and then we just serve faithfully until Christ returns. Now, maybe you've done that already. But you realize that maybe your commitment, maybe there's something in what we went over this morning just doesn't line up with where you are right now, but you're not satisfied with that, and that's good. And you want to rededicate yourself to doing, stepping out of the boat, staying committed in what you're doing. And you can do that and never step down here, because it's not me you're committing to, it's the Lord and His service. So I want to encourage you to do that today. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. What is it, Tony? 183? 183, Whiter Than Snow. And we're going to sing the first and the fourth verse of these hymns. And I want to encourage you that if you have a decision to make, to come as we stand and sing this hymn of invitation. 180.